tiny in all that air. The Philip Larkin Society podcast.
Hello and welcome to Tiny in All That Air, the Philip Larkin Society podcast. My name is Lynn Lockwood. So we're now in 2022, and this is going to be a really exciting year for the Philip Larkin Society as we prepare to celebrate what would have been Larkin's 100th birthday on the 9th of August. We're hoping to get as many people as possible involved all across the UK and around the world. Writers, artists, dancers, librarians, fellow literary societies, and of course, podcast listeners. It's going to be action-packed. So keep an eye on our Twitter accounts and Instagram, listen out to the podcast, read the member newsletters, have a look at our lovely refreshed website, and there'll be lots of announcements in the months to come. My guest today is Dr. James Underwood from the University of Huddersfield, whose amazing research has recently been published under the title of Early Larkin. He joins us to guide us through the early years and explains why reading Larkin's poems, stories and letters written even when Larkin was still at school can give us so much fresh and fascinating insights into the writer himself. So, yeah, do you want to start off then just letting us know how you first discovered Larkin, really? How did you get into Larkin?
Sure, yeah. Well, I think there's probably two questions there, isn't there? How did I sort of get into Larkin in the first place, and then how did I get into Larkin academically?
Yeah, that's true, yeah, yeah.
In terms of how did I get into Larkin, well, I'm from Hull. I was born in Hull,
oh, right.
Grew up in Hull. And I think if you're from somewhere like Hull, you grow up there and you don't think of it as a poetic place, right? But if you're a kind of, you know, a bookish child, which I was, to then find out that there was this great poet who lived there, but who also wrote about the place and in a sense kind of made it poetic, you know, brought it into major canonical 20th century poetry, then it's quite a big deal, really. And it makes you see the place again. And it makes you appreciate the place a lot more as well. So it was that kind of personal link that kind of made me notice Larkin in the first place and made me want to read his stuff and find out more about him.
Yeah, it's interesting, isn't it? Like, people from Hull, although Larkin might have a bit of a ambiguous relationship with Hull sometimes, you know, especially when he first went there, people from Hull seem very keen to talk about, you know, that Larkin was from there. And everybody's got like I think I might have seen Philip Larkin, or my dad did some decorating at the university, or, you know, people seem to enjoy trying to find a link to Larkin, and it's as if he's got a link to everybody in Hull, and he has in a way, hasn't he? It's amazing. I can't think of any other poet or writer that does that to people.
Yeah, but it is a big deal. It is a big deal, Once you get into Larkin, you then learn that actually there are all these other fantastic poets who are also from Hull, or who moved to Hull, or who spent time in Hull and that kind of thing.
Yeah.
You know, people like Douglas Dunn. And then you learn all about that. But I think often Larkin is the kind of gateway to all of that.
Yeah.
You have to find Larkin, because until you find Larkin, you just don't think it's a poetic place. You don't think it's a significant place in that sense.
Mm.
So I think it doesn't surprise me that people from Hull are keen to make a big thing of that, because I think what Larkin can do for a place and what he can do for a person's appreciation of places is really significant.
Yeah. So did you first read Larkin when you were at school? Can you remember getting your first edition of Larkin poems or anything like that?
So we never studied Larkin at school, interestingly, I suppose, given that we were in the area.
Mm.
But I was just curious. So I bought the green, the 2003 collected poems, which I've still got and which I still primarily use, and just got into Larkin that way. And then it was really when I was at university that I sort of got into Larkin academically.
Yeah.
I did my undergraduate dissertation on Larkin.
Yeah.
And I think if there's one thing that kind of underpins all of the work that I've done on Larkin, from my very kind of amateurish undergraduate dissertation to the book that I've published, it's this feeling that there are so many misconceptions about Larkin.
Yeah.
And wanting to kind of have my say about those things, and wanting to sort of do something about those misconceptions. I think one of the misconceptions is that Larkin's poetry is really easy and straightforward, and it's self-evident what all of these poems are about and what they mean. I think a lot of critics say that, a lot of the scholarship on Larkin, to be honest,
really
says that, I find that quite frustrating, and I'm not sure we're really doing Larkin much of a service by saying that. I think Larkin's poetry is complex, and there's a huge amount of hidden depth there. I don't want to overstate the point. Mm. I think you can read a Larkin poem and get an awful lot out of it on a first reading, and that is a big reason behind his popularity, I think, and that's a good thing. But there's an awful lot of complexity and hidden depth, and it was quite frustrating to read all of this criticism that says, "Well, isn't it obvious? Isn't it just obvious what this poem is saying? Isn't it just obvious what this poem is about?" I mean, think about a poem like Livings, that three-part poem he wrote. That is such a strange, enigmatic poem. And
that's the poem with the lighthouse keeper.
Very strange. There's an Oxford Don in one of the poems, and there's the other one's about an agricultural salesman.
That's right, isn't it?
It's such an odd poem, such an enigmatic poem. How do the three poems fit together?
Mm.
It's so historically textured. That is far from an obvious poem. So I think that underpins my sort of academic interest in Larkin, is sort of getting really into the work and the hidden depth of it and the complexity and the literariness as well. And there's so much. There's so much there. And if you listen to a lot of people, you would think, no, there's not much there, but there really is.
Yeah, that's really interesting. So I know you're sort of talking about the complexity in terms of sort of meaning and resonance and allusion. And I really like what James Booth does in terms of, for me, I learned a lot reading James about meter and structure in Larkin, because that's incredibly complex as well. And the only other writer that I felt taught me as much about meter and form is Robert Frost. And Robert Frost, again, on the surface looks simple, and he's very popular because of that, and very sort of simple imagery of the pastoral imagery. But when you get into Robert Frost, it's very philosophical and also very complex as well. And I think there's some really interesting links between Larkin and Frost because of that.
Yeah, I think there's a lot in that, actually. I might have got this wrong, but isn't Robert Frost one of the books Larkin said that he sort of had within easy reach of his death?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah,
And you can really see the similarities, as you say. It's there's this surface layer of a kind of easygoing, kind of persona talking to you in both poets, but you get underneath that, and it's incredibly complex, as you say, formally as much as anything else. They both make it look so easy, don't they? They make it look so easy. the writing of poems, the crafting of poems. But actually what both of those poets are doing is so difficult. It's that it's so incredibly well crafted.
Yeah.
And I really appreciate that aspect of Larkin and poets like Frost as well.
Yeah. So why do you think then Larkin, we have talked about this before on the podcast, but why do you think Larkin is just not as widely taught as some writing, not even as widely taught as Frost, you know? I know there's the issue around sort of personality and you know, the kind of maybe some of the ideas expressed in some of his letters and things like that. We know that kind of controversial side. But, I mean, in terms of the, you think by certainly by the time you got to university level, that wouldn't have been an issue. So why do you think at university he is so sort of marginalised?
Well, in terms of the teaching of Larkin, I'm not convinced he is marginalised. I think he seems to be a perennial of the secondary school curriculum and university English departments. Where he does seem to be marginalised is more in terms of the research happening. And I don't know, is there a link between the two things? Is there a link between the sense that the poetry is all very straightforward and, you know, a couple of readings and you've sort of exhausted the poem, and, you know, I guess if that's your perception, then you might be quite put off writing a dissertation or a book about Larkin. I don't know, but he seems to be taught quite widely.
Yeah. And he certainly seems to be a favourite of English teachers. And, you know, every English teacher most that I've worked with over the years have got a few Larkin poems that they will always try and get onto the, you know, into the classroom at some point for all kinds of reasons. And there's no question about his place in the canon. But that's interesting that perhaps we don't get enough people wanting to actually research. But I mean, I've seen some, obviously now as part of the Larkin Society, we're becoming what I'd like to think of as a bit more of a hub for research and for people, you know, like yourselves and Alex Howard, you know, that we're getting to know you all and getting to find out more about what research is going on out there, and Clarissa as well. So, you know, hopefully that all continue to develop. And obviously we've got our publications advisory board. So I don't know if you wanted to talk a little bit about that and where you see the future of Larkin research and how it's linked to that.
Sure. Yeah. Well, as you know very well, the Larkin Society has just been incredibly busy, hasn't it, in recent years, and incredibly active and really kind of diversifying the work that it does and its offer. And I know that you've been keen as a society to kind of use this moment to take stock of what you're doing in terms of publications. And so for that reason, I was asked to come on board as founding chair of the publications advisory board. So a kind of subcommittee, if you like, which will advise the exec committee on everything it's doing in the realm of publication. So looking at what it's doing currently and thinking about how that might be developed, expanded. Also looking at other things society might do. So in the longer run, could the society be publishing books on Larkin? You know, whether those are academic books or trade books, coffee table books, you know, whatever it might be. That sort of thing. And I think it's partly what you say, isn't it? It's about creating more of a home for any research, any scholarly activity on Larkin that is going on. And not just kind of creating a home for it, but hopefully actually then stimulating more, generating more of it. I think that is a really important function that the society could kind of go on to serve now, is generating a lot more academic activity.
I think there's so many more opportunities now that the world of publishing has completely transformed in the last sort of generation, that we can look at things like e-publications and, you know, different kind of models for getting things out there. And I think, you know, just the podcast technology in the last few years, where it's so straightforward and, you know, it's really kind of brought a different type of way of exploring Larkin, for example, and just, getting things out there really and making connections between people. But I think it's really fantastic if we may be going down the path of having a, you know, an academic journal and having a as well as our society journal, and how that might develop. Actual books would be fantastic. You know, and kind of connected to that a little bit, we're very subtly relaunching our website at the moment and trying to make the website a much more dynamic kind of centre for publications of all kinds as well. You know, I think it, with the excitement of social media, websites got a little bit neglected over the last few years. But actually, I think we've taken another look at the website and thought, no, this could actually be a really good place to go to for information and for links and for research, hopefully, and make it a really good resource for people as well. So, yeah, you've come along at a good time. I think there's a lot of ambition in the society at the moment.
Yeah, I think the society is in a really strong place. Actually, you look at some literary societies, and whether this is by design or by accident, they're very, very scholarly, and that's really the only kind of thing that they do. Whereas I think the Larkin Society is doing all sorts of things, and it's reaching all sorts of people. So that is a really, really strong base to build on. And as I say, hopefully provide that kind of home for anybody with a scholarly interest in Larkin and generate some more work on Larkin.
Definitely. Yeah. And also anyone that wants to buy a Larkin tea towel or yeah, wants to come and see us in the park and do some Larkin colouring in. I think I guess it's in a way, we're a bit like Philip Larkin, aren't we? We've got kind of different ways of communicating and just kind of being out there in the world, you know. We are all volunteers, but I think we've got a really, it's always been an amazing group of people, you know. I mean, the people have changed and people have stepped down. But when you look back, even, you know, if you read James Booth's history of the Philip Larkin Society that he put in the journal, it has just had amazing people running the society right from the start, and, you know, amazing HVPs. It just seems to, be a really kind of fascinating group of people that come along to the Larkin Society. So obviously that's no reflection on other literary societies. So I don't really know who run the other literary societies, but I do feel like really honoured to be part of this team of people. And I really love the social media, how we've managed to pull in lots more people. So I just feel like we're a really big team now that's all around the world. And we're always welcoming new people along and people that want to contribute in different ways and get involved. And I think there's lots of ways to do that now, thanks to social media and thanks to kind of technological things. And hopefully now in the new year, well, we're in the new year, but later in the year and into next year, we can start going back to more physical events, you know, and we've got all of what's going to go on in the summer for the centenary. And hopefully that will be on the ground in Hull and across the country. And we can all start seeing each other in person again. And that will just, I think that'll be the ideal place where we can all be. So I've got you to come along primarily to talk about early Larkin. It's an area that we have covered on the podcast before, to some extent. We've talked to James Booth about Brunette Coleman, and we talked to David Quantick as well. We've obviously covered a little bit about his life and his letters and his relationships. But I think, you know, what you've done in your book has taken Larkin as from his, you know, teenage life up, and it ends at the Less Deceived, doesn't it? And really shed some light on how this is an integral part of his development as a writer, rather than just the kind of damp squibs or false starts that kind of narrative that people sometimes say, oh, well, yeah, Jill's not a bad novel, but, you know, he was never going to be whatever. And I think you've wanted to challenge a lot of those kind of assumptions about early Larkin. So I wondered if you wanted to just kind of introduce us a little bit to where you were going with the book and how you got started with it.
Yeah, sure. By the time you get to The Less Deceived, there's this kind of relatively stable, coherent, poetic voice, isn't there? And the collections that follow on from that. I don't want to overstate that point, because as I was saying earlier, I think there's a lot of kind of diversity in terms of the voices and the personae that Larkin's mature poetry makes use of. But there is this relatively coherent poetic voice that you might call the Larkin-esque.
Yeah.
If you work backwards from The Less Deceived, then there's just so much going on in terms of Larkin's writing. Most obviously, he's writing in all sorts of different forms. So he's not just writing poetry, but he's writing novels, short fiction, essays. You know, at times he's even writing plays and verse dramas and things like that. So there's an awful lot going on in terms of different literary forms, but also literary different genres. He's really kind of playing around with different personae, different authorial identities. And I think one of the things I wanted to do with this book was to try to sort of read that all together. So not just look at these things in a very bitty way, but sort of pull them together and to see whether we can say that there is some kind of literary development arising from all of this different work. So it's not his kind of personal development that I'm interested in here. It's not kind of psychological or biographical. It's his literary development. Can we pull all of these seemingly quite random different things that he's doing together and sort of trace some kind of development? And I think we can, really, and that's really what the book is all about. I think when you look at early Larkin, he's kind of got two problems, right? One of his problems is he's really obsessed with his literary influences. And he tries to copy them. And that means he's not original. So that's one of his problems. The other problem is he seems in his early writings to be really preoccupied with himself.
Yeah.
But the problem there is that, you know, I'm not knocking anybody here, but if you're sort of a middle-class kid that's gone from grammar school to Oxford University and you're sort of 19, 20, 21, you know, your experiences are probably not enough to be the kind of stuff of great literature, right?
Yeah.
So that's his other problem. He's sort of obsessed with writing about himself and his private experience or experiences, but it's just not really kind of generating much for him. So those are his two issues. And then what happens kind of around about 1943 is he starts experimenting with different authorial identities.
So this is coming towards the end of his university, or is he just as he's graduating from Oxford?
Yeah, well, even before that, really. Mm. So he's, as he's kind of working towards his final exams, you know, should be head down.
That's an ideal time to work, though, isn't it? The last thing you want to do is study. I'll just go and sit and do some writing instead.
Yeah, well, yeah, I mean, Brunette Coleman is sort of like the ultimate exam procrastination, isn't
yeah.
it?
Yeah.
But yeah, it's round about that time, final year at university, preparing for final exams. And it's even before we get, it's before we see the brunette common stuff, actually. There's a story he writes called An Incident in the English Camp.
Yeah.
And he includes his name in the title. So he calls it An Incident in the English Camp by, I think he calls it A Thoroughly Unhealthy Story by E.A. Larkin.
Mm.
And that's kind of interesting because that wasn't really the way that he put his name to his work. Mm. He was Philip Larkin, right? So sort of including himself in the title, but sort of slightly changing his name, to me just suggests there's just that little bit of distance between, you know, the actual Larkin and the kind of the author of the story. So already, this is the point, already he's sort of taken one step back from himself.
Yeah, and did you make the point that there's also a gender ambiguity of that once you just use an initial, that it could have been Pamela Larkin rather than Philip Larkin?
Exactly, because the protagonist of the story is a young woman called Pamela.
Yeah.
So it at least raises the possibility, doesn't it, that the author of this story is a Pamela Larkin rather than a Philip Larkin. So you can already see the seeds of the Brunette Coleman project there.
Yeah.
And I think this story is so interesting. It's not a great literature. You know, I'm not trying to make that kind of claim for a lot of these writings, but it's so interesting because what he does is he sort of takes all of the conventions and the sort of expectations of that period's romantic fiction, you know, so kind of, you know, women falling in love with good, clean living officer class soldiers, you know, that sort of thing. And he sort of inhabits that genre of romantic fiction, but then completely turns it on its head. Because towards the end of the story, the protagonist, Pamela, has this kind of fantasy in her head where she rescues Robbie, her sweetheart, who's a soldier serving in the war, and she sort of rescues him in the Libyan desert, but she's dressed as a man. So there's also that sort of gender bending content in the story as well, as possibly in the title and in the author. So he sort of turns the genre on its head. And the reason why I think that's so interesting is because he's not making the same mistakes that he's been making in his writing up till that point. He's not just imitating his influences, first of all, and he's not obsessing over himself and he's really sort of taken a step out of his world and written a different one. And that's the story, if you like. That's what I try to argue in the book is that once Larkin takes that decision to kind of come out of himself, to inhabit other people's lives, perspectives, worlds, stories, that sets him on track, and it's quite a long and sort of winding journey that he has to go on, but it sort of sets him on course for the great poems that, you know, we all know and read and love.
And that kind of opens up that possibility that we should always bear in mind that even the great poems aren't necessarily Larkin's voice. You know, even the famous poems like Whitsun Weddings or Dockery and Son, you know, the ones that we totally believe are Larkin toads, for example, there's all the personas behind that as well. We're not just sitting behind Larkin's eyes for the rest of his poetry.
Exactly. So when you then do get to The Less Deceived and The Whitsun Weddings and High Windows, yes, there's, as I was saying, there's something Larkin-esque about those poems, those collections, but it's exactly as you say, those collections are full of personae and role-playing and messing around with voices and genres and conventions and expectations and things like that. And what I'm trying to argue is you can trace that that all the way back to early Larkin.
Yeah.
So in that sense, there isn't this great big chasm between early Larkin and later Larkin, which I think is a narrative that's been put forward an awful lot.
Yeah.
Actually, that chasm gets a lot smaller when you realise that what Larkin was kind of messing around with in his work in the 1940s really does sort of pave the way for those really, really great poems of the 1950s onwards. And I also think, I mean, look, different people will have different ideas about what exactly it is that makes Larkin such a great poet. For me, I think one of the things that makes Larkin so great is that interest in other people. That he doesn't just obsess over himself and his private experience, but he really tries to get into the heads of other people. So think about, you mentioned the Whitsun weddings. That's a really good example. Afternoons.
Yeah.
That's a good example. Even the Mower. I mean, that is a poem about a hedgehog, you know?
It's
not about people, really. It's about a hedgehog, but it's still such a sort of empathetic poem that tries to make connections with others and otherness. And that's one of the things I really appreciate about Larkin. But it's his early work where he really started doing that.
Yeah. And there's a lot in his early work that is of really good, well, you know, I don't want to kind of make value judgments, but there is a lot of stuff in there that's really good as well. I mean, the, you know, the Trouble at Willow Gables, it's not going to be to everyone's taste, you know, because of the genre. But, you know, things like the essay, What Are We Writing For, is brilliant. The Sugar and Spice poems, you know, there's some amazing writing there. So it's not even, I mean, the Jim Sutton letters that we're going to come on to, there's some amazing writing in the Jim Sutton letters. So it's not even a case of this is just him, you know, developing and being an apprentice. It is the writing apprenticeship, but there's absolute brilliance in there already right from the beginning. And there's plenty of humour and experimentation and fun and you know, empathy and creativity in language. There's lots to be found in these early writing. So again, you know, just to say, oh, don't worry about it. Maybe have a read of Jill and A Girl in Winter and then just get on to The Lusty Seed. I think you're actually missing out on quite a lot of fascinating Larkin reading. So I'm always pleased if people have a go at going back to the early Larkin and having a read of it, because they may well be surprised at how much they actually enjoy it.
Yeah, I think that's right. And, you know, if you look at the poems he wrote as Brunette Coleman, so under the title of Sugar and Spice, I mean, some of those poems are really bad, but when I say they're bad, I mean that they're sort of bad in a really deliberate, knowing way. And there's, you know, that there's something really sort of funny about that. Some of the poems are quite extraordinary. Particularly Femme et Damnée. There's the sort of the version of Baudelaire that he writes. You know, he writes that in 1943 as Brunette Coleman.
Yeah.
But then literally decades later, in the 1970s, he publishes that poem under his own name as Philip Larkin. Mm. And as far as I can tell, nobody particularly batted an eyelid, right? Nobody sort of read that poem and thought, hold on a minute, this is nothing like the Philip Larkin that I know.
Yeah.
So it's really interesting, isn't it, to think that poem he wrote in 1943 as Brunette Coleman, actually he can publish it in the 1970s under his own name, and it just sort of gets folded into his body of work.
Because
it's such a Larkin-esque poem, isn't it?
It's absolutely brilliant. Yeah, well, David Quantick read it and talked about it, and I just think it's a stunning poem, and there's so many images in it that are so Larkin-esque, you know, when he talks about the sort of plots of cabbages and the Green Line bus and all that kind of domestic setting around this very, you know, this quite ambiguous kind of traumatic relationship between these two women that's being played out in front of it all. And it really is a Amazing. I mean, when I was talking to James Booth about this, and he was reading, the School in August, it actually made it very moving. It's actually something, you know, very, again, quite empathetic about it, even though it's about schoolgirls. He brings something to it, Larkin, that you wouldn't expect.
It really takes you by surprise. I think that because if you read those poems sort of in order, so in the sort of order of the manuscripts in the archive, you start off reading, you know, like a poem about a schoolgirl sort of hurriedly cycling to W.H. Smith to get this book on horses that she really wants. You know, it's such a silly poem, deliberately silly poem, and it's sort of cute, but it's sort of facile, you know.
Yeah.
And then you sort of work your way through the poems, and then you get to those poems you've mentioned, and, you know, The School in August, for example. And as you say, they're really poignant poems.
Yeah.
And you're not ready for that.
No.
Because you think you're just getting silly, facile poems, and then it really takes you by surprise. Mm. And as you say, you know, that imagery of housing estates and buses and the milk on the doorstep.
Mm.
We're sort of properly into afternoons territory there.
Yeah.
Some weddings or here or whatever it might be.
Yeah.
But he's doing that in 1943.
Yeah.
Not in 1953.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it's definitely worth people going back to. It's only about seven poems, I think, isn't it, in Sugar and Spice?
Yes.
Isn't it? Yeah. And then very different from the poems of the North Ship. You know, the North Ship is very influenced by other writers, as you said before. But when you hear Larkin's voice in the Sugar and Spice poems, that's the Larkin-esque voice. It's already there, already developing. So did you want to talk about some of the Jim Sutton letters? Do you feel that would be a good time to do that now?
Yeah, that correspondence is one of the things I write about in the book. There's a whole chapter dedicated to the letters with Jim Sutton, because it is a really extraordinary correspondence. And one of the points I would make is some of Larkin's best writing of the 1940s is in those letters.
Mm.
They are kind of extraordinary literary documents, as well as, you know, just sort of biographical documents. And that's what I was really interested in. And particularly the way in which Larkin is using that correspondence to really sort of construct this artistic identity for himself. So Jim Sutton at that time was he was an aspiring artist. He just started at art school before being conscripted into the army during the Second World War. So you've got Larkin, at that time aspiring novelist, and you've got Jim Sutton, the aspiring painter, and Larkin sort of really uses this correspondence to construct this artistic identity for himself. And so you get this really, really extraordinary writing that I think Larkin's letters to Sutton, they're real kind of journeys. You sort of, sort of meander all over the place in these letters, because you get lots of sort of social history and these little details about what's kind of going on, whether that's in the news or in the house or whatever it might be that day. But then also you get these sort of pieans to the sort of writers that Larkin was worshipping at the time, writers like D.H. Lawrence, Catherine Mansfield. And then you get these really extraordinary passages about art and about what it is to be an artist and that sort of thing. Shall I read one of the letters? I'll read this one. This one's from the 16th of August, 1945. So it's written the day after Japan's surrender. So it brings to an end the Second World War. So he says, "My dear Jim, well, the war ended yesterday. We have come through, which 6 years ago I thought unlikely. God knows what fate we have been reserved for, but that one fact is good enough for the moment. Congratulations to you on your survival. Now I hope you'll be able to get back home and do what you want to do for a change. And then it's sort of typical Larkin. You get these really prosaic details about how he's been to Devonshire for his birthday and he's had two baths and it's really cold. And then he sort of complains about work. And then he says two fireworks go bang outside. So you get that, you just get that little insight into people celebrating and what's sort of going on out on the streets and that sort of thing. And then you sort of get this change of tone. He says, yes, I look forward to our meeting again. I do really. What it'll be like, I don't know. But I feel at the moment that all my friends have proved too limited. I have people whom it is a pleasure to drink with or write to, but I want someone who is really with me, right down to the root. It's hard to explain. I have friends who are kind, witty, and even sensitive, but I need someone who consciously accepts mystery at the bottom of things, a person who devotes themselves to listening for this mystery, an artist, the kind of artist who is perpetually kneeling in his heart, who gives no fuck for anything except this mystery, and for that gives every fuck there is. Is this you? I believe it is. You see, we shall be so lonely if we can't give each other faith. Alone, I am beginning to faint and fall. Together, we shall be no more successful materially. If I am ever famous, it will not be for ages, probably till I am dead, because I will not push myself. But we shall do better work. We shall become more faithful artists. So I think that passage is, it's sort of one of those really extraordinary passages that I was talking about in amongst the sort of grumbling about work and the weather and having baths and, you know, that sort of thing. You just get this really intense, quite intimate as well, I think, passage about what it is to be a true artist and how you have to kind of attend to that and how Jim Sutton is the only person who really understands that. And so it's a really extraordinary letter.
They are so beautifully written. And I know Maeve Brennan in the Philip Larkin I Knew goes back to the Jim Sutton letters as her kind of defence of Larkin as somebody who was sensitive and who was, you know, thoughtful and, you know, full of kind of empathy for the world. And I think it's this kind of passage, isn't it, that she quotes as shown him at his best. And again, before she knew him, and as a very young man, he's barely lived a life at this point. It's an interesting balance and an interesting how he doesn't show that much interest in World War II, does he, in his letters? It seems to be a bit of a nuisance, really, and he's a bit sniffy about everything that happens.
Yeah, he is. Yeah, definitely don't read the letters if that's your kind of interest. You know, what was it like to live through the Second World War, that kind of thing? You know, he sort of mentions it, but it always feels a bit like something that's just on the periphery.
And it's just
annoying more than anything. Yeah. Just getting in the way of sort of doing the things he wants to be doing. And a lot of his mates are, of course, actually sort of serving in the war. Yeah. So their life is really on hold as well. So, it's an irritation alongside, you know, cold weather and, you know, people who talk too much and things like that.
Yeah. Yeah. And he was forced into quite an unusual relationship with World War II, I suppose, being left at university, whereas most of his friends were called up and he didn't have the fitness to be able to do that. And Oxford at that time would have been quite an unusual place anyway, wouldn't it? Because there would have been they had a lot more female students there, because obviously Monica was there, although he didn't know her at that point. And it must have felt a very strange place to be, with a lot of his friends knowing they could get called up at any minute. And very disruptive kind of life to live. And obviously he had to rush home at one point, didn't he, to Coventry to find out if his parents were still alive. But even that kind of, it gets resolved quite quickly. His parents were still alive. He had a bit of a torturous journey getting there. And I don't know how you live this kind of through this world without suffering terrible trauma, but he seemed to cope with it by regarding it all as a bit of a nuisance and just getting on with it, really.
Yeah, I mean, there's even just, you know, a little revealing detail in Jill where John Kemp goes to one of his lectures and the lecture theatre it's all women.
It's all women. Yeah.
Because that it must have been what it was like. It must have been quite odd.
Yeah. And I know sometimes that can be used as a bit of a stick to beat Larkin with when people try and look for, you know, the misogyny in Larkin, which I would argue is quite hard to find, really. Mm. But obviously he was living in a world where the role of women was changing very dramatically at that point. And it must just been, I can't imagine what it must have been like to live at that time as a young man with artistic ambitions. So do you want to explain a little bit about what happened with the relationship with Jim and the future of the friendship between Jim and Philip Larkin and what impact that had on him?
Yeah, it's a little bit sad in a way. I mean, what happens is the correspondence becomes really very intense, and particularly over the course of the war, and they're corresponding from a distance, obviously, because Sutton is actually serving abroad. So it is this very intense correspondence, and that passage I've just read kind of gives you a flavour of that. By the time you get to the sort of late 40s, early 1950s, it really starts to peter out, the correspondence. They write to each other much, much less frequently, and it's really not as intense or intimate. Mm. It's much more polite and just kind of doing your duty of eventually replying to the letter. And I think really that's because Larkin's writing, his literary career, is taking off. Mm. Jim Sutton's artistic career, his career as a painter, never did take off. I think he ended up becoming a pharmacist and a landlord. Not that kind of great artist, that great painter of the future that Larkin was really setting him up as in the correspondence. So I think in a sense they almost run out of things to say. So it peters out.
And Larkin's correspondence with other writers like Kingsley Amis became, well, that's a whole nother book, isn't it? Larkin and his correspondence. And again, another place where he plays multiple roles and, you know, the persona that he takes on with Kingsley Amis is very different from the persona that he has for his mother and for Monica and for, you know, Barbara Pym. And it's fascinating that he continues to do that through all his letters.
Well, yeah, I mean, with a lot of these correspondences, remember, he's writing them at roughly the same time. So at the same time that he's writing those really extraordinary letters to Jim Sutton, as you say, he's writing these really, really coarse, crude letters to Kingsley Amis. And I suppose, you know, the question is, what do you do with that, right? What what do you do with the fact that Larkin seems to be all things to all people? As you said, Maeve Brennan, she uses the Sutton letters as a defence. You know, this is the Larkin that I knew. You know, this is almost, you know, this is the real Larkin.
Yeah.
I'm not so sure about how successfully you can sort of pick out a Larkin and say, this is the real Larkin. I think for me, given everything I've said, what he's doing in letters is really just an extension of what he's doing in his literary work. He's playing around with voices. He's playing around with persona. He's trying outfits on and he's seeing what it's like to be this person and then that person. Because that's what writers do. I see a girl dragged by the wrists across a dazzling field of snow, and there is nothing in me that resists. Once it would not be so. Once I should choke with powerless jealousies. But now I seem devoid of subtlety, as simple as the things I see, being no more, no less than two weak eyes. There is snow everywhere, snow in one blinding light, even snow smudged in her hair as she laughs and struggles and pretends to fight. And still I have no regret, nothing so wild, nothing so glad as she rears up in me and would not, though I watched an hour yet. So I walk on. Perhaps what I desired, that long and sickly hope, someday to be as she is, gave a flicker and expired. For the first time, I'm content to see what poor mortar and bricks I have to build with, knowing that I can never in 70 years be more a man than now, a sack of meal upon two sticks. So I walk on, and yet the first brick's laid. Else how should two old ragged men clearing the drifts with shovels and a spade bring up my mind to fever pitch again? How should they sweep the girl clean from my heart with no more done than to stand coughing in the sun, then stoop and shovel snow onto a cart? The beauty dries my throat. Now they express all that's content to wear a worn out coat, all actions done in patient hopelessness, all that ignores the silences of death, thinking no further than the hand can hold, all that grows old, yet works on uselessly with shortened breath. Damn all explanatory rhymes, to be that girl, but that's impossible. For me the tasks to learn the many times when I must stoop and throw a shovelful. I must repeat until I live the fact that everything's remade with shovel and spade, that each dull day and each despairing act builds up the crags from which the spirit leaps. The beast most innocent that is so fabulous it never sleeps. If I can keep against all argument such image of a snow-white unicorn, then as I pray, it may for sanctuary descend at last to me and put into my hand its golden horn.
Do you know, if you didn't know this was by Philip Larkin, you wouldn't know it was by Philip Larkin.
It's a really strange poem. It's exactly what I was talking about earlier. It's
yeah.
So enigmatic, so mysterious. It's not really like a lot of the other poems in the Northship either. I think what I say in the book is that it's got Brunette Coleman's fingerprints all over it. There's kind of like a handful of poems in the Northship where you can really tell that he's sort of written this, you know, around the same time as or shortly after the Brunette Coleman experiment. And I think this is the most obvious one, because of course you've got that initial image of a girl being kind of playfully dragged through the snow, and this kind of fascination with her and what it must be like to be her. I don't think it's a sexual interest. I think it's just a genuine fascination with what it must be like to be this other person. It's such a strange kind of aspect of the poem, but that fascination with, you know, the opposite sex, I mean, that, you know, it's there in the Brunette Coleman works, and then I think it's also there in some of the mature poems, like Wedding Wind, for example, which, you know, he literally writes from the perspective of a newly married woman. But I think, you know, there's sort of something else going on in this poem, because David Timms, who's one of the critics who's written about this poem, he says that the poem is in dialogue with three of Yeats' poems, particularly Sailing to Byzantium. And in that poem, in Sailing to Byzantium, you've got a sort of old man, you know, coming to the end of his life and sort of looking forward to eternity. And eternity is sort of golden and, you know, perfect. And it's this kind of mythical place. In this poem, in Larkin's poem, what does he describe himself as? He calls himself a sack of meal upon two sticks, which is a really unflattering description of himself, and sort of makes himself sound like the old man of Yeats's poem. But he's not an old man. He's a young man. He says he's got 70 years ahead of him. And of course, we know that Larkin was a very young man when he wrote this poem.
Yeah.
What poor
bricks I have to build with. It's like he's got no potential. He just sees nothing in himself that can grow almost.
And the weak eyes, which were the reason Larkin wasn't able to be conscripted.
Yeah.
So it's not an old man approaching death and the afterlife. It's a young man feeling very sort of dissatisfied with his lot. And what you get in the poem is you get this kind of contrast or tension between the kind of ethereal beauty of the girl and her sort of happiness and the snow and, all of that imagery. And then the more sort of real world workaday imagery of the two old ragged men clearing the snow away with their shovels and spade.
And they're right at the centre of the poem, aren't they? They're physically the kind of pivot of the poem, which is really interesting.
Yeah, they are. And it's, I'm pretty sure it's about them that he says, the beauty dries my throat. So it's not the girl that provokes that reaction. It's the two old men shoveling snow in their sort of ragged coats. And so to me, it's a muse poem. It's kind of debating sort of which direction the poetry is going to go in. You know, is it going to go down the kind of Yeatsian route of golden artifice and eternity, and or is it going to sort of stick here in the real world, in the actual world? And right at the end of the poem, you get that image of the snow white unicorn and its golden horn. And of course, it's a really traditional poetic image. That is, it's very mythical. Mm. It's Yeatsian.
Yeah.
And that might suggest that okay, he's decided, right? That's the road he's going to go down. But what he does is he kind of spoils the image, if you like, or he vulgarizes the image by making it sexual, because the unicorn puts its horn into his hand. So he vulgarizes it, and that sort of suggests that I'm not going to go down that kind of Yeatsian road. I am going to sort of, I don't know, I'm going to keep all of these things in play, the kind of golden eternity, but also the here and now, the real world, the sort of gritty reality of the world I live in, and sort of keep all of these things in play in my poetry.
It's a real poem of sort of opposites and dichotomies, isn't it? Even that first line, I see a girl dragged by the wrist. It takes him quite a long time before he tells us she's actually laughing and pretending to fight, as you do when you're in the snow. A lot of what you do when you play is about laughing and pretending and slipping and falling and all that kind of stuff. But I think people sort of see the violence in this first. You see the violence in this first before you see the sort of joy or the kind of, freedom in the poem, the playfulness. And it's clearly, there must be a sort of deliberate effect there that he's taking you down one path all the time in this poem and then takes you down a different path. As you say, you think the poem is about the girl, but actually it's about the old men.
But then, he sort of goes back to the girl, doesn't he? And he says, no more explanatory rhymes to be that girl, but that's impossible.
Yeah.
So it's such a strange poem. It's such a strange opening to the poem. I still don't really feel like I completely understand this poem.
No.
It's just so enigmatic. He does seem to be having this kind of debate in the poem, but he's sort of having a debate about poetry, but it's also through the lens of gender, isn't it? It's the contrast between the youthful girl and the old men, and it's really interesting. It's, to me, it's just so clearly a sort of post Brunette Coleman era poem.
Mm. I like that line, everything's remade with shovel and spade. You know, it's a poem about work or commitment and repetition. Because that was something, again, it comes up in Larkin's poetry, you know, liking toads. He often states a kind of ambiguous relationship about work and commitment. And yet he was the person of everyone who worked hard and showed immense commitment to friends and partners and his mother and the library and everything else. So there was always that, he was very vocal about that, or kind of explored that in himself a lot, didn't he? That he had those mixed feelings about it. Sometimes he thinks, I want to throw everything up and stuff your pension. And then other times he's just there and he needs to be there every day. He needs the shovel and the spade. That's what gives him, that's what makes him who he is. That's what, you know.
Yeah, yeah. So it's a work poem as well, isn't it?
It's
anticipating toads and toads revisited. But I think, you know, round about this time, he's learning that the job of being a writer is really hard. It's going to be hard, you know, to get where he wants to be. There is no shortcut. You can't just write like Yeats and then everybody will think you're just as great as
Yeats. Yeah,
you have to sort of pick up your shovel and get to it. And
get on it, yeah. Each dull day and each despairing act builds up the crags from which the spirit leaps. You certainly could argue this is a poem about work and creativity and inspiration. It's not all about, like you say, trying to just waking up in a Yeatsian mood. About actually putting in the spade work during the day. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. It's fascinating. It's just so mysterious.
Yeah, and as we were saying before, about the reason why the artist Nick Cave and his the singer and artist Nick Cave and his wife Susie Cave were blogging about this poem, because I think they like the imagery of the snow and the kind of the strange sort of dreamlike imagery and the unicorn and everything. I mean, one of his albums has actually got a unicorn, I think, on the front cover. So you can also read this poem on that level as well, can't you? Just sort of astonishingly gothic, dreamlike imagery.
Yeah.
Which, when you think, if you're in the same breath, you're talking about it being a poem of work and you're also talking about a gothic poem about unicorns. It's pretty amazing, really.
Yeah, it is. But I suppose it's like, you know, Dublinesque.
Yeah.
Where it's sort of both about kind of the gritty reality of, you know, prostitutes in Dublin, but it's also this really sort of dreamlike, otherworldly poem, or the Winter Palace. I mean, I know that poem was sort of cancelled, you know, for editorial reasons, but it's a real shame because it's such a beautiful poem, and it's snow, isn't it? It's the imagery of snow, and that sort of represents almost like oblivion, like an just another world. So there are sort of continuities.
It's a great poem to read, actually, and in the light of what you've done in Early Larkin, you can see a lot of strands being pulled together in this poem, which is really interesting.
Exactly, and again, it means that Early Larkin, whether you're talking about The North Ship or his novels or whatever it might be, Early Larkin is not really this false start.
Mm.
Yes, it does appear to be very, very different in so many ways, his early work, but it isn't a false start. It is just laying the groundwork for what's to come, but he's just doing it in such a sort of strange way with all of these different experiments that it can be hard to see that, I think.
Yeah. And I think anybody that wants to do a bit of a deeper dive into Larkin, if they've very become probably quite familiar with the main collections, I'm sure they'll get a lot out of going into Early Larkin. And obviously reading your book as well, because it will take them through it.
Well, hopefully.
It's a huge amount of research you've done there, because he wrote a lot, didn't he, before he came to even before he started The Less Deceived.
He did, and there's, you know, there's a lot of material that isn't in there, you know. I couldn't and didn't write about everything. There's so much more in the archive. He was really writing very, very intensively.
He's very prolific. And was he writing diaries as well at that point as well, do we know?
I think he was, yeah. We know that he was keeping a dream diary whilst at Oxford.
I think he was,
you know, keeping a diary, and of course, as we were talking about, keeping up his correspondences, and so just writing all of the time.
Writing really. And doing his university writing and reading as well for his actual degree. Yeah.
For his degree, but then then his own private diet of reading, because he was very sort of unsatisfied with what Oxford gave him, I think. So.
Yeah, he was very industrious and still managing to get out to the pub quite a lot. and still enjoy himself.
Yeah.
Go out on bicycle rides and all the other kind of thing. And he was absolutely, like, prodigious, really, with the amount that he did and the amount that he produced. So are you researching any different areas of Larkin now?
So I think what I'm becoming interested in now is... Well, I guess it's almost like the next step on from, you know, leaving the book at The Less Deceived, sort of becoming really interested in the movement and Larkin's relationship to that, because there's not actually been an awful lot of work done on the movement, which is weird because it comes up so much in when people tell stories about post-war literature and how it sort of developed and that sort of thing. The movement is always so central to those narratives, but actually there isn't an awful lot of work on it. And I think with a lot more scholarship on Larkin that's been published over the last, you know, decade or so, I think it's sort of ripe for reassessing Larkin's place in the movement, but also the other writers, because there are some really fascinating writers within that label. So that's my interest now.
That's really interesting, isn't it? Because I think some people kind of see the movement as a bit of a spurious sort of label, that it never really existed. I think that would be really interesting to go back and have a reevaluation of that. We need to get Blake Morrison along.
Yes, that would be really interesting, because I think his book is so good. His book on the movement is really, really good. But I still feel like there's more to be done there.
Yeah, and as each new generation comes through, there always will be a new sort of reevaluation and seeing new links and new connections. I mean, I think, you know, in 20 years' time, we'll be ready for a new biography of Larkin. I think particularly when Monica's letters become available for general readership, I'm not sure how long that is. It's still a few years away. And I'd really like to see a woman's voice in a Larkin biography, because obviously we've had Andrew Motion and James Booth, and I think it would be really good to have a female kind of a re-evaluation of Larkin and bringing together all the new kind of strands of research, you know, like yourself and the new things that we've learned about Larkin. There will always be a time to re-evaluate James Booth's biography, to re-evaluate Andrew Motion's and look afresh at him.
Yeah, I think when the Bruce Montgomery archive, when the embargo is lifted on that, I've got 2035 in my head. So it's still a long way away, but I think that'll be really interesting as well. And another opportunity to look at Larkin, particularly in this period.
There will be. And I think Larkin scholarship and hopefully the reading of Larkin, I think we've already seen he's such a universal writer. And a global writer, I think. You know, I've been looking at, I've got Anthony Thwaite's collection of the Larkin's books now, and there's a lot of a lot more overseas translations than I realised were. You know, there's French, Italian, Japanese. There's a, I think, Dutch or Scandinavian languages. And I know he's well read in South America, because we get South American tweets in Spanish and Portuguese, which I just assume are complimentary. And I do think he will continue to be seen as, you know, one of these sort of timeless writers that can be read by anyone.
I think so. And if I'm wrong, you know, if Larkin is not this poet who makes connections with other people and who sort of, you know, tries to inhabit other people's lives and worlds, then why is he so popular, and why is he so popular in all sorts of times and places?
Thank you so much to James, and I hope you'll agree, a brilliant start to the Larkin year. And I really hope James will come back to talk more about early Larkin with us. So, a hello to a few new Twitter followers, and we're nearly at 600 now, so I'm hoping by the end of 2022 we'll break that 1,000 mark. That would be amazing. So, hello to @BookwormNorth, @GingerGreenProductions in Hull, Deirdre Thompson, Mike Ulliott, Caroline Hett, and Isabel Tracy. And thank you to everybody that follows and makes comments and gets involved. It's a lovely, positive community. As you know, this is going to be a crazy busy year for the Society. So Tiny and All That Air is going to be a bit like the number 9 bus, and may not always be on time, but it'll always be along the way, taking the utmost care and attention to the passengers at all times. This podcast was produced by Simon Galloway, and the opening music is The Horns of the Morning by The Mechanicals Band. And as ever, if you have any comments or any suggestions, I love hearing from you, so please get in touch. Bye.
The horns of the morning are blowing, are shining. The meadow is wet with the coldest of dew.